Hello, this is Will Faber from Art to Ride, and today we're beginning a new series on how to bring your horses up from the stretch. And of course, how to recognize when they are ready to come up from the stretch, and all the little danger points along the way that we want to be able to recognize to be sure we're on the right track. I realize in the last few clinics that a lot of people are now getting the idea of stretching their horses and are at that phase of, well, when are they ready to come up and what's the next step? So that's what we're going to try to cover over a five or six video series here over the next week or so to give you guys a better idea of that. So here we're starting off with Bailador. One of the things I would look at with every horse before they're ready to come up to stretch is that they're usually about the stage where this horse is. That is that they can be lunged without any kind of side reins or anything else and will stretch. And in all the cases that we're going to look at here with us, because this is the hardest thing and many of you are facing the same thing, if horses have already been overflexed in the neck, there's that difficulty of they may be ready physically in the rest of their body to come up before they are ready in the neck. Bailador was a very damaged horse when he came to us. He was extremely broken over the neck, had the beginnings of kissing spine. His left leg he could put no weight on when he stood. It just, he kind of kept his weight off it and the leg kind of shook all the time. He had, you know, many veterinarians thought he had neurological damage. And really all that damage was just damage that had been done to his back. He was extremely sway-backed, extremely shark-finned kind of horse where his back had just dropped away from those withers. And he was really an extreme case. I actually call him the second most difficult horse I've ever trained. So it's taken great difficulty and great pains to bring him to where he now is. And most of that is just patience waiting for it to happen. As you have all heard me say many times, horses that have been overflexed in the neck, you simply have to wait for them to heal. And that always takes a year to 2 years. And with this horse, it took even longer than that because he had such extreme damage to his back. Remember when we started this horse, he had an imprint that looked like a badly fitted saddle on his back that literally went all the way to the bone. In other words, his muscle had atrophied so far in his back that he literally had the pattern of a saddle on his back that had kept him, his blood from circulating so badly that it had deteriorated all the muscle all the way to the bone in the shape of a saddle on his back. So he was a very extreme case that took a very, very long time, and he had also been driven out of his mind. He's a very sensitive horse and a very big horse. So once again, he's finally at that place where he's ready to begin coming up. So you can see how there in the walk, I was able to stretch him in the walk without any shambone, anything on. Now you notice when I work horses without side reins or without a shambone or anything else, I'm going to go over the top of the head and over the top of the pole with my line just so I can keep a nice feel of the horse's mouth. I prefer that to some people like to put in a thing that combines the reins kind of together underneath the horse's jaw, and I do not like those at all. I find it very hard to get a feel of the horse's mouth. So if I don't have anything connected to the horse, I'm just going to go over the top of the pole. But you can see how nicely he came into the walk and just stretched in the walk, and how easily he's come now here into the stretch in the trot. And this is a horse that it took years when you even trying to lunge him, he literally just ran around you like a lunatic. Yeah, but we can see how nicely he comes into that stretch and stretches that neck all the way down and does that right away pretty much out of the box at this point in time. And we can see how his neck, you can really see how the top of the neckline is lighting up the entire length of the top of the neck and how much he's filled out. And I must give a shout out here to our good friends at O3 Animal Health there, because it really was, we felt a great help to him. Their oils, their weight gain formula was really important for this horse, more than any others that we've seen. This horse had always had difficulty keeping weight on. This last winter was the first time we've ever been able to keep on weight on him throughout the winter. And then, of course, summer would come, and he'd have the same when it got hot. That would take all the weight off of him. Now he's really sustaining his weight really well, and we really feel like the O3 Animal Health products have really helped him a great deal. So if you have a horse that is having a little difficulty weight-wise, couldn't recommend that more. I think oil should be in everyone's diet, including human beings, and the oils that they provide are wonderful sources of that for our equine friends. So once again, getting back to Bailador here, we notice how beautifully he's stretching into this contact. Once again, you can't see the break in his neck. With this horse, even for the first few years, it was even stretching down without anything on, he would curl back behind the bridle. That's how severely broken he was. So this is a sign that you're always going to see on horses that are ready to come up. Now notice that his neck no longer just hangs directly down. Some we talk about how low should horses stretch. Well, low enough to engage the back, so that's different with each one of them. and many of them that you guys have seen, how what they have no top line at all, the neck will just plunge directly down from the withers straight down, and that's perfectly fine, and that's where you'd want to leave it until they gain enough strength, as you can see with this horse, how the neck just starts carrying itself up, and you can really see the ball rolling over the ground here. Remember last week we talked about that a little bit, and in terms of, you know, yes, we want the ball horse to be round like a ball, but a ball that's moving, that has energy moving through it. So that's the thing I always want to add to that idea of a horse looking like a ball. You know, yes, we can stand still and get them to lift their backs up, but it's never going to be very good until they're actually moving, you know, and that the movement contains that energy moving through the horse, just like a ball that's rolling forward has energy that's causing it to roll forward and keeping that perfect shape. Well, that's what we want the horse to do too. So we can see here that he clearly is able to walk, trot, and canter, keep the neck out in front of him, stay in a stretch. This is a horse who, when you cantered him for years, the head would just throw up in the air and he was completely upside down and he would just, you know, canter rather manically. So we can see that's all gone. So this is the first step in seeing that a horse is ready to come up. You can see how he's, as I said, they begin to come up all by themselves. The neck begins to just carry itself out as the horse begins to engage the top line. It's almost like, as I said, like engaging your bicep muscles. We want to see it light up entirely evenly over the length of the horse's back. So that was a great little warm-up for him in one direction. And we're going to go the other way to just to be sure that we have the same thing there. So if your horse is at this stage where he'll stretch into the contact, stay there in all three gates, he's probably ready to begin coming up into a little higher level frame and carrying himself up a little higher in front. Now that doesn't mean that they're going to ever carry themselves like that all the time. We're always going to want to go back and forth to the stretch. And that's the thing we have to get in our idea, in our mind with horses, that it's not just affixing them in some position that they're just going to come out and immediately go into. You know, that's what people have tried to do so often with horses, and that's where training goes wrong. We've got to look at them, you know, just like any other athlete. They have to stretch, they have to warm up, they have to warm up into the highest level they can work and warm back down again, just like a human athlete. That's why it's so important that our human athletes involved with the sport keep themselves at the highest level of fitness to understand what the animal goes through in trying to do that. If you have no concept of maintaining physical fitness yourself, you're going to have very little empathy for the horse. So it's very important that all of our riders do exactly the same thing that we're trying to expect our horses to do, that is stay in the best possible shape that we can. If for no other reason, that you'll be a happier, healthier person by virtue of it. So, you know, if you're not in perfect health, this is certainly what you should be doing for yourself. Horses are not machines that we park in the garage and go turn them on. You know, but even your car, if you don't change the oil and just keep driving it, will eventually burn up. Well, that's essentially what happens to horses that don't get the correct maintenance that they need. So you can see how right away there he was just able to walk right out in a nice stretch. No problem at all. Just go right into the trot. How beautifully he comes through. And once again, once he really starts to swing, take a moment and take your hand and just block off the neck of the horse and look at the rest of the horse moving. You'll see that if you don't look at the neck stretching down, the horse is lifting its front end off the ground. So many people, when they talk about whether a horse is on the forehand or not, all they're looking at is whether the horse is stretching forward again. But as I said, if you look here and you block off the neck so that you can't see the neck with your finger or hand as he's going around there, you see he's lifting up quite nicely in front. That is, the thrust of the hind leg is beginning to lift the front end off the ground and get it out of the way so the back end can swing through. That can only happen, remember, if the horse's back is round. Why it's so important to the movement. And of course, there will be no shock absorbers on the horse. But you can see how clearly here he's just stretching nicely into that contact, but his neck is not carried straight down anymore, nor is he curling back anymore. So when the horse can carry itself like this, I can pretty much guarantee you it's ready to come up from the stretch, or the beginnings of coming up from the stretch. But we'd want to see that before we'd expect that to happen. Also, the canter here, look how nicely he goes into the canter, the neck stays out in front of him. This is a horse that always, as soon as he cantered, threw his head straight up in the air. It's part of his problem is he sort of was self-perpetuating his own back issues in that every time his back was sore, he threw his head straight up in the air, then cracked his back down, and that made his back even sorer than it was to begin with. But now we have a horse that looks quite happy in his work. He's not in a panic any longer. He's not in pain any longer. and therefore he doesn't mind being worked any longer. So I said it's natural for a horse, a healthy horse, to want to move. So the first things we have to start looking at when horses don't want to move is what's wrong with them. And in every case I've ever seen, there was always something wrong with the horse. Not just that the horse was a lazy so-and-so, as people would like to think. You know, horses are whatever we've made of them. If they're a lazy so-and-so, you've probably made them into such a thing. They're probably so out of shape that they're not able to do the work. So there's our prerequisite for coming up the stretch, that the horse is basically now carrying itself in self-carriage over its back. So what I'm going to show you now is a technique for bringing them up in the reins. So what we do when we want to begin to bring the horse up in a little higher level frame, we don't want to connect side reins if we're going to use side reins to bring them up, which is a good thing to do. We don't want to have the side reins hooked to the side, because if we start to tighten side reins, when they're hooked to the side of the horse, they will just pull the horse over very easily. So if a horse is correctly trained and everything has been done correctly, what we do is we hook the side reins up to the top, just so they come at the same angle that your hand would come from, that is right up there by the withers. So if the horse has been trained correctly and everything has developed correctly, what you'll find when you put that on, now if I had put side reins on this horse, you know, years ago, all like this, you can see that this horse, the side reins are not holding the horse down in any way. All they're doing is just shortening the reins a little bit. But we still want the horse, if everything we've done up to here has been correct, the horse will, in a very short moment, just stretch directly down into that contact, which is exactly what it will do with your hands if all this work has been done correctly. As Nunu said in his book, the best hands in the world just work just like a pair of side reins. They simply limit the length of the rein without any backwards tension. That's my part adding on there. They had no backwards tension. So you can see how, as I've gone to the trot here, how he's just stretched right down into the contact with those side reins. So now I'm limiting how far he can stretch all the way down. But I still, as we always do at the highest level of collection, we always want to feel that the horse wants to stretch into the contact with the reins. We always have that feeling that the horse wants to go into the reins and round its back. But you can see now here, by just limiting that stretch a little bit, how he's already beginning to lift up a little more in front, as we can see. And the biggest thing here is it hasn't deteriorated by taking this little bit of contact. I haven't deteriorated the trot. In fact, it's improved. So by now, by taking that little bit more contact, he's rounding up through the back a little bit more, but stretching beautifully into it. In other words, we see that by taking the contact with the side reins, it did not shorten his stride. I still have the same stride that I had when I was lunging him all the way down with nothing on him at all. So that's exactly what I want to see, and you can see how the cadence is a little better, cadence being that accentuation of rhythm. So when we say that a horse is in rhythm, remember we're always talking about the two ends of the horse being in rhythm together, not the speed that it's going. A horse can go at a consistent speed around the ring and be completely out of rhythm, and that's the thing people need to realize. We talk about rhythm is that perfect rhythm between the back and the front end that can only happen when the horse is working over its back. But look how beautifully now this horse is stretching into the contact. And we can see by having that little more contact there and bringing him up a little bit, we see how the top line even engages a little bit more. That is, you see how the top of the neck looks a little bit fatter, so to speak. And he's actually even reaching deeper under his body as now the stride is completing itself all the way to the bridle and he's holding himself up in a little higher level frame. So there is a beautiful working trot for this horse. Now notice here he's not breaking over in the neck anymore. I've tried this many times along the way with this horse's test to see where he was, and every time in the past, you know, up until the last recent times here, every time we would try to do that, he would just break over in the neck, which tells me he's not healed enough to be able to come up yet, because once the horse breaks over in the neck, it's like having a short circuit in your wiring. Nothing is going to work very well. So you can see even here in the canter, he lifted his pole up a little bit, but he's continues to canter, stretching into the contact with the bridle, and how that's even getting better. There's a horse over its back in the canter. Now notice this horse looks very stable. When you get that kind of canter, the back does not swing back and forth. As I said, it's very popular. People are talking about how horses these days should feel like a rocking horse. I saw a very well-known clinician sitting on a little rocking horse telling people this is how your horse's canter should feel like. Well, folks, nothing could be further from the truth. If your horse feels like a rocking horse, it's not over its back. In other words, it's going up and down behind. But watch again that this horse comes into the canter, and look how the back stabilizes. It's like a wave that refreshes itself before the wave breaks. If the wave breaks, that is, because the horse is hollow in the back, you'll get that rocking horse kind of feel. Instead of feeling like, yeah, you're lifted and then you start to go down, but before you get that rocking feeling, the wave refreshes itself underneath the horse's back and you're carried forward. That's what you want it to feel like, not like a rocking horse. Unfortunately, there's so much misconceptions out there. So many people today and clinicians who have made themselves famous by buying up every magazine cover. Folks, if you don't know how that works these days, most of the horse magazines are just like the old dog show magazines used to be. You can literally make yourself famous today by buying up the covers of the magazines, which they're happy to sell you, and they'll basically print anything about you that you want to say about yourself if you buy advertisements. So beware of the people that you see, and you know, the fame that we see people accumulating by virtue of just getting into the popular horse media. Usually these days, it's just like the music business is. It's all pay for play. So beware of that. And as I say, always look behind the ribbons and behind the fame that the people are actually training themselves and what they're turning into and how long they last. As I said, the hallmark of a great horseman is how long their horses last, not how many ribbons they have. Anybody can buy an expensive horse these days and win a bunch of ribbons until the wheels fall off. So you can see how beautifully he stretched right down into that contact again. And once again, notice by virtue of keeping that contact a little bit more, we see a little more lift in the horse's back. So that begins to lift the top line up. And you see how the bottom of the neck stays very relaxed. And you can see when he does come up that little bit and begins to tense the bottom of the neck, how it has an ill effect upon the movement of the horse. But look how beautifully he's stretching into that contact now. And this was a horse that was completely broken over in the neck and just a runaway kind of lunatic. And look how beautifully he's getting in the zone. And this is the whole workout. If you've seen me, you know, we didn't have to go through any times of him running like a lunatic on the lunge line or any of that kind of thing the way this horse used to be. It took a very, very long time and a great deal of patience. And once again, we want to thank his owner, Leslie, for being willing to take the time to do this right with this horse, because it's taken really quite a long time and he's been a very, very difficult horse. But look at what we have to show for it. So hopefully all of you have learned a great deal by seeing this horse's education and realizing how long it can take with some of them. But if you never give up, if they're sound enough, you know, and a lot of people would have given up on this horse. Trainers who trained him had, you know, became afraid to ride him and wouldn't even get on him, things like that, you know. But what a beautiful animal he's now turning into. But he's a very big horse, and unfortunately that's often the fate of the big ones, is they get in the hands of people who are afraid of the size of their movement. You know, every horse has to work at its optimal gates, and if you shut that down, they're going to become very frustrated, and then in a case like a horse like this, they're going to become in a great deal of pain, because once the back drops and they start developing kissing spine, as we see so often these days, I mean, it ought to be a no-brainer when people look at, you know, the result of what people's training is these days. The result of your training is there's a hollow back horse with navicular, no matter how many ribbons you've won. It couldn't possibly be very good. But look how beautifully this horse now just stretches right into this contact. And once again, you can see how when the reins are connected at this point, how the horse stretches right into it. And that's always how they should be connected when you want to begin to bring the horse up, not along the side. When you have the horse side reins connected to the side and you tighten them, it just draws the head and neck over into the chest. So that's perfectly fine when they're very long, but not at this stage. When they come up, all you do is hook them on the side and they'll come up beautifully, as you see he's doing, how the neck even stays up in the canter, and we see that canter stabilize. So this is absolutely beautiful for him and shows me how much he's developed, and this horse is really ready to begin and stabilize the trot up in the working frame. Once again, you can just see how much lift there now is in the trot. He's lifting that front end right off the ground. So this is what I'd want to see, and look how beautifully that downwards transition, the neck never shortens. So that's what we're always looking for, not to shorten the neck, but to engage the entire top line of the neck. So that's the horse beginning to come up into the working frame. exactly how you should do it on the lunge line and the danger signs that you want to look for. Now I'm going to show you a little piaff with this horse. Now I've been gone for a while, so he hasn't been piaffing. So this would be the first time he's done that since I was in Australia. And you can see he gets a little fussy there, wanting to go back. And you see I just lightly touch him on top. He gets a little confused about what he's supposed to do there as he begins to engage the back. But watch what happens here as he relaxes. You can see how that back, the hindquarters, begins to lower behind. So it's not about at all about getting the horse to lift its knees up. It's getting the lower, getting him to lower the back end. You can see how he pushes up. But notice how long the neck is. As he's getting better here, notice how I'm keeping the neck out in front of me. Now, some of these horses that are very difficult and are very disconnected to their back, the piaff, once you learn to do it, is a big, big help with very nervous horses and disengaged horses, as long as we do it. As you can see him, I'm not holding him back. Once he got into the piaff, he's very, very relaxed in it. And I give him some little touches just to engage him. But just that much. It's not like I'm pounding on him. If I were abusing him in any way, he wouldn't want to stand there. And you can see how light my reins are. Also why horses have to be trained correctly. Now you can see the ball forming. So my goal here is to bring those hind legs closer to the front end, get the neck out longer, and just get him to drop those hindquarters and begin to push up through the entire length of the back, up through the withers, like that. Now that's really quite nice right there. It's becoming quite rhythmic, and that's all I ask for. This is Will Faber from Art to Ride. See you soon with the next series.